Today's talk is on mental development through Buddhism. It's going to be a very short talk. First, I'm going to talk to you about mental development. So the first part of the talk will be on mental development outside of Buddhism. Second part, mental development within Buddhism. Right? So the main important point here is whether the mental development we are talking about is quality mental development in the sense that it is wholesome, good, or it is unwholesome and bad. So that is the end of the talk, very short. But if you would like to stick around for me to explain a bit, I don't mind, you know. Anyone want me to explain the talk? Sure. I was hoping you say yes. Otherwise, I have to go back and don't have a chance to share with you any knowledge. Okay, that was the joking part. Now, mental development we can find in many places. The usual kind of mental development you get in schools, right? Colleges, universities, what our parents try to do to us, you know, is supposed to be considered mental development. Now, let us now talk about some of the mental development that are a bit special. People always like to hear about mental development that are special, you know. Okay, now you know that in order to pass the examinations and so forth, you have to have a very good memory. Not only a good memory, you must be able to recall what you remember and then write it on a piece of paper. Hopefully it answers the correct question. Now, we are very fortunate because right now in Malaysia, we have got this kind of facilities open to you, you know. You can actually go to a company and get this kind of training. I believe the company's name is Ernest Co. You know, it's a subsidiary of the Fleet Group. Fleet Group of companies under Straits Times and all that kind of thing. And now this technique of mental development was developed in a country I believe called Bulgaria. They developed this technique whereby once you have learned this technique, you can learn any subject. You will have very good memory and you can recall. They tried this technique years ago in a number of schools in Bulgaria. And they found that these students who have gone to this technique have 100% passes. 100% passes. As if that is not enough, they pass with more than 90%, over 100. All of them. So it's a fantastic technique. Now, but this technique, you only learn how to remember and how to recall. And I believe those people who went through those techniques, some of them developed what is known as a photographic memory. Photographic memory means simply this, that when they wish to recall anything they remember, they actually see, say they want to remember a page of writing, they actually see this page of writing in their mind, you know. If they want to remember page 145, they actually, in their mind, they can turn over the book to page 145. They actually see the page in their mind and they go word for word, you know. Right? Which sentence and for sentence down the line. That's the meaning of photographic memory. I've actually talked with somebody who have got this type of memory. Like just like a picture. The eyes may be open, but they actually see the picture in the mind. So here is also a kind of mental development. It develops memory power. It's the mind. The question is, does it guarantee that this person can use the mind, you know, to remember good things, you know, wholesome things? Another kind of mental power you can learn from in some of the communities here, they're very hush-hush about it. It is called the power of chi, you know. So the power of chi, they call it chi kong or whatever, you know. The power of chi. Now, if you have read these martial arts magazines and so forth, then you will know that the Japanese also got the same method, maybe slightly different. They call it ki. And those magazines come from Japan, some from USA. Now, those people are able to develop their mind to such an extent that they are able to send the force, the energy through the body and even out of the body. And then, for example, they can take some chopsticks and throw the chopsticks at a plank of wood, and the chopsticks will stick, you know, go through the plank of wood. Right? Actually, it's not the chopstick that went through the plank of wood, but it is this energy called chi or ki by the Japanese that goes through the piece of wood. And then you have kids in US and so forth who will pierce a nail to their hand, hang a bucket of water and wave it around. After that, pull up the nail and you don't see any hole, you know. No blood, nothing. So they have developed this power of chi or ki to quite an extent. So here again is through the mind, you know. We're talking about mental development here again. Right? Again, it does not guarantee the quality of that kind of mind power. Because that kind of mind power can also do evil, just as much as it can do good. So it does not guarantee that the person who owns this kind of power is going to use it for good. It doesn't guarantee that the person who owns this kind of power will not get himself into trouble. The chances are he might even get himself into more trouble. Because when you have more power to play around with, you tend to abuse it. And if your power is fantastic, you might abuse it even more. Now let's look at another kind of mental development that goes beyond this development of chi or ki. It is to be found in certain branches of Buddhism, of Hinduism, and they call it developing the kundalini. Developing the kundalini. It seems that there are these points on the body, right? Directly down the front, there are around 6 points. And then if a person is successful in developing the energy to pass through these 6 points until it reaches the top point here, these points are called chakras. Right, until it reaches the crown chakra, right, and is able to control the movement of this force up and down, then he has developed, he has what you call, had a breakthrough to this kundalini, right? So in Switzerland, you've got this Indian guy there, his name is Gopi Krishnan, and he has successfully gone this, achieved this breakthrough. And then he will have a doctor, you know, trying to listen to his heartbeat. But the doctor will find that his heartbeat has already stopped. But at the same time, he will still be talking to the doctor, you know. He'll be talking, he'll be playing chess or whatever. But the heartbeat has already stopped. Right? And then he has never played chess in his life. But because of this development of this kundalini, it seems, he can, you know, play chess with many people at the same time and win at those games. He doesn't know how to play any musical instrument. He can pick up any musical instrument and play like a professional. So when he developed this mental power, he's able to do all kinds of wonderful and wondrous things. Here again is another kind of special development of mental power. The question is, the person who can throw this kind of mental power, does that person use this mental power in a good way? He's got mental power, he can perform wonderful things, but can he direct it to good? Does it guarantee that this person is spiritually developed? Does it, you know, for example, assure this person, right, that he can live a better life? Or can he abuse that kind of power? So mental power and spirituality are two different things. To be spiritually developed and to be mentally developed can be entirely two different things. Now the beautiful part about Buddhism is that when you develop mental power through Buddhism, it also at the same time guarantees spirituality. That means spiritually you get purer. Not only do you have mental power, but spiritually you become purer. For example, those people who have undergone meditation and things like that, some of them in the process of going through meditation, they might have some kind of serious sickness and so forth, and they find that they cure themselves. Right? Some of them will have cancer and things like that. Some serious sickness, and they cure themselves. At the same time, the mind is pure, spiritually pure, because the process of developing the mental power, they go through a different kind of process, which not only develops the mental power, but also purifies the mind and guarantees the spirituality, the purity of the spiritual self. That is the kind of mental development through Buddhism. Let us take, for example, before we get on to the meditation part of the mental development, let us just look at Buddhism itself. I think you all know that Buddhism itself gives you the freedom of choice, whether you want to follow it or you don't want to follow it, you know. Nobody threatens you and say that, you know, you don't follow Buddhism and this thing and that kind of thing. Buddhism, they do not put fear into you and threaten you that you'll be damned forever and ever and ever and ever. Forever and ever you'll be damned, you know. Right? Burning all the time. Probably doing disco in hell or something like that. But it'll be hot, really hot kind of disco. I see a lot of young people here, probably you go to discos as well. But, I mean, some other religion, they give you those kind of threats and all that. Here there's a freedom of choice, you know. You choose, right? Whether you want to follow or you do not want to follow. And I think about Buddhism that we know is that Buddhism places the responsibility on the follower, right? When you follow Buddhism, you are being put into the driver's seat, so to speak. That means, in Buddhism we teach about karma, the cause, the law of cause and effect. We are what we are today is because of what we did in the past life, what we did last year, maybe even yesterday. And we will be, later on in the day or tomorrow or years to come or in the next life, depending on what we do today or tomorrow. So, the responsibility is you. You yourself are responsible for what you have become, and you'll be responsible for what you're going to be. Now, as a result of being responsible, you find that you have to use your mind more. Right? Whatever you want to do, you have to use your mind more. You have to think. Because if I do not do the correct things, if I do not think the correct things, if I do not say the correct things, then my life could be going downward or my life can be worse off than what it is today. Right? So it forces a person, it encourages a person to develop their mind to the use of this thinking and deciding and being in the position of responsibility. You know, here is not a situation, in Buddhism is not a situation whereby, you know, all you got to do is just pray and pray and pray and pray and everything will be A-okay, you know. It doesn't happen this way. I mean, you can, in other places, you can do all kinds of wrong, you know. You can cheat, you can steal, you can kill and everything. But once you are converted, you just pray, you'll be A-okay, man. Everything is washed clean. Alright? Very easy, yeah? No responsibility on your part. Alright? Because somebody up there is responsible for you thereafter. So, does not encourage your mental development there. Don't you think so? Huh? Am I making sense to you? Or am I only making sense to myself? Because you are so serious, you know, sitting there so serious looking at me. I didn't know that Buddhism is supposed to be so serious. When I was talking to you, was my face looking very serious? I thought I had a very smiling face. And I don't see anybody smiling back at me. Okay. Now, let us look at, for example, the practice of Buddhism. We know that basically the practice of Buddhism can be divided into three simple things. The practice of giving, the practice of virtue, the five precepts, and the practice of development of the mind or development of or purification of the mind, called meditation. Very three simple steps. We know that when you practice giving, you have to even think wisely who to give to, what to give to, whether the things you give can be beneficial to the person, whether the person you give to is worthy, you know, can give you good returns, you know, good karma, good merits, you know, that kind of way. So you think, even the practice of, you know, five precepts, for example, right? And remember those days when I was just learn about Buddhism. That time I was around 18 years old or something, you know. I learned about Buddhism. So then I say, okay, now onwards I'm going to practice the five precepts, you know. I was quite happy and quite proud about it. So I went out, you know, thinking that here I am, a guy who is practicing the five precepts, you know. So I went with my friends, you know, that time I was staying in Penang. And I went with my friends and we went to this food stall along Gurney Drive, you know, next to the seafront. And then in this, there are a few stalls there, they were selling char kway teow, you know, they were selling this cuttlefish, and they were also selling cockles. So both of us went there and we ordered cockles and we ordered char kway teow. So we enjoyed ourselves eating the cockles and eating the char kway teow, you know. Alright? Then I went back, you know, and then when it was time to go and discuss about, you know, Buddhism with this person who teaches me Buddhism, then he said, you are practicing the five precepts. I said, yes, of course, you know. Do you observe the first precept, you know, not to kill? He said, yes, of course, I mean, I've been observing since I learned from you, you know. He said, do you go and eat in this Gurney Drive and all that? I said, yes. Do you happen to have ordered cockles or anything? He said, yes, of course, we had it last night, you know. And then he said, do you look at the cockles and all that? I said, we have got to look at the cockles. I didn't know about it. He said, do you know that when you order cockles, the cockles are alive, you know? And then the person boils it. And then it becomes dead and then he serves it to you. Next time you go to the same store, you go in and check the cockles. I tell you, I've got a fight on my life, you know. I said, I'm supposed to be practicing, you know, this five precepts. And here I am, you know, I've broken the first precept, you know, a number of times, you know. How many cockles have I killed, you know? And after I told myself I'm supposed to be observing, you know. Alright? So there you are, we have to be very careful, right, in practicing the five precepts. Isn't that right? Nowadays you go to restaurants and all that, when you order fish, you have to be very careful, you know, not because you have got those fish swimming in the tank. As you order the fish, the guy goes there and take out one, throws inside for you. Even if you order prawns, the fellow might bring this prawn there, and then you find the prawn jumping, doing the disco in this liquor or something like that. Doing the disco there, they put the live prawns inside, be jumping there, The guy says, okay, actually the prawn doesn't feel any pain. I don't know, that's what he says. It's never been a prawn, I suppose. But anyway, that goes to show you that just keeping of the five precepts, all right, you have to exercise your thinking. Isn't that so? You have to exercise your thinking, correct? Otherwise, just to keep it good and pure, it's not as easy as just observing, right? And you find that as you exercise your thinking, you're more careful, you're wiser about it and all that, then you find that you observe the precepts better, right? And then your virtue becomes, purer. And as a result of your virtues become purer, the five precepts is a very great protection for us, If you have a key or any kind of thing, a person takes a gun and can still kill you, Not to say that if you have the five precepts, it won't kill you. But because we practice the five precepts, for example, the non-killing part, because we practice it to such an extent, the purer we practice it, the greater is the protection for us. Mainly by the law of cause and effect. Because when we practice these precepts pure enough, the mind, our mind, gives out vibrations, gives out vibrations all the time. Alright? Things give vibration. For example, red color gives a vibration. The red color gives the same vibration as you play in the piano C. The piano keys, A, B, C, D, E and all that, C. If you multiply this C tune many, many, many times, it becomes red color. So red color gives off a vibration. Similarly, our mind gives off vibrations. And if we practice this purity of virtue, it gives off the same vibrations of non-harm, non-killing, non-harm. So those people who want to harm you, they will not come near you. If they think of shooting somebody, they will not shoot you because, you throw off those kind of vibrations that they don't see your face. When they think of killing, they just don't see your face. You could be right in front of them. They will never think of killing you because the mind is capable of throwing out those kind of vibrations through the practicing of virtue. So the virtue, they said, is the best talisman that you can get. And I believe it's very true, You just practice it and you find that it gives you all kinds of protection. Sometimes you just cannot avoid danger. When danger comes to your house, you cannot avoid danger and you face the danger and you find that your practice of the precepts gives you the protection and the danger moves away from you. It's very interesting how it happens, So there you are. Here we are talking about mental development here. Through the practice of virtue, the mind is developed to that degree that is able to vibrate protectiveness around a person. Now isn't that fantastic? That means it guarantees you good things coming your way. It guarantees you, bad things not approaching you. I think that's very fantastic, don't you think so? Yeah, you're not convinced that the mind can give off vibrations, is it? I mean, do you think the mind can give off vibrations? It can. If you have got this, they call it able to take a Killian photograph. It's a kind of photograph, a kind of a technique of taking photographs. Call it Killian photography. Killian photography, or Killian photography, something like that. Now, you put a person in to sit on a chair, he sits there for about half an hour. You remove this person and you use this camera and you take a picture of the chair. You will still see the shape of that person on the chair. That person has left the vibrations, the energy force behind that on the chair. And this kind of photography can pick up that energy force. And this energy force is directed out by the mind. Yeah, I think if you look at some of these magazines on popular science and all that, some of the issues, you should be able to see that. And that is enough proof to you that the mind actually vibrates and gives off energy force. Now to it's nearly 11 o'clock. What time did I start? 10:15, is it? After all the singing, Actually, it's very embarrassing, to come and give a talk after singing. You know why? Because the guy in front was having such a sweet voice, singing and strumming away. Then I said, imagine I'm going to go up to speak after him, and my voice is very croaky and all that. It's quite embarrassing for me. It's just a joke. Don't take it seriously, okay? The singer, please don't take it seriously. Now, what was I going to say? Meditation. All right. Let's see how meditation in the Buddhist sense helps mental development in the right way. Okay, I think that will be very interesting. Now, the meditation process in Buddhism, all right, before you take on the meditation in Buddhism, you are advised to keep your virtues. Right? Because the process of Buddhist meditation goes very deep into a person's mind, what the Westerners call the subconscious mind. Yeah? Westerners are good at conscious and subconscious mind. Right? That's the way they divide it, and that's the way all of us know it. In Buddhism, they've got 52 states of mind or something like that. Westerners only got two, conscious and subconscious. Very easy. Alright. So there you are. It goes very deep into your mind. And if your virtues are not pure, if you don't keep the five precepts, alright, then your mind cannot sink into those levels. Alright. And those who break their precepts like anything, right? Then what happens is when you meditate, you begin to have all kinds of imaginations coming up from your mind. Why? Because the impurity of the virtues is being registered into the mind, deeper levels of the mind. And when your meditation goes into those levels, the pictures, the symbols of what you have done comes up to the surface. Right? It comes up. And you can actually see it as if it is right in front of you. So if you have done, break the precepts all the time and all that, when you meditate deeply, these pictures come up. They float up in your mind. I remember that at one time when I was doing meditation, I was attending an intensive retreat. And there I was meditating very seriously there, and then sitting there and all that. And then I thought I was meditating, And then suddenly I see this, myself eating this food, what was the food? The Chinese call, the Hokkien call it tau yu ba. That means it is pork cooked in black sauce. Pork cooked in black sauce. It's one of my favorite dishes. So I see that, I just love it, When it's cooked the right way. So when I was meditating, I could actually see this in a very clear picture, you know, full color, and I could see the strands of the meat, you know. All right, so beautiful and so tasty, you know. All right, and I was lifting it in a spoon, and I was about to put it into my mouth, you know, while in a state of meditation. Then suddenly, you know, I went back to meditation, and then I say, yeah, I'm supposed to be meditating, and then this picture comes out, you know, boom, comes out. You know? So that's why in Buddhism, when you go into deep meditation, we advise to keep your, you know, the precepts very clean. Eh? Right? So, because any kind of pictures and things like that can come up. Eh? Right? And there's also another reason why you advise to get somebody who knows meditation to guide you along. Just in case you go off track. Eh? The Chinese call it Chao Fo Yap Mo or something like that. Chao Fo Yap Mo, they call it. But so long as your virtues are clean, then the Chao Fo Yap Mo doesn't happen here. Excuse me, uncle. Chao Fo Yap Mo means that the person becomes crazy, you know. In Buddhism, you don't become crazy, actually. For example, when you try to achieve the deeper levels of qi, or to break through the kundalini, you might go off track, you know, and you become crazy. The same Gopi Krishna, who is now so fantastic at this developing of kundalini, in the beginning of his life, he was mad for around 6 years. He went mad for around six years. Then he came back again, and he practiced again, then now he's successful in breaking through the kundalini. So during those 6 years, the candidates will say, Chao Fo Yap Mo, you know, right? So anyway, in Buddhism, so long as, you know, you've got a good guide, and then the virtues are clean and all that, there's no situation of this, you know, getting off your rocker. So there you are. Here we are talking about this morning is mental development. So anyway, in Buddhism, so long as you know you've got a good guide, and then the virtues are clean and all that, there's no situation of this you know, getting off your rocker. So there you are. Here we are talking about this morning is mental development, true Buddhism. And like I said in the beginning, is that Buddhism gives you not only mental development, but also the purification of the mind, the purity part of the mind that comes with it. I see one or two people sort of falling asleep, you know, going off. Is it my voice or the face, I think? Maybe I've got a sleepy face. No. Okay, so the mental development through Buddhism is a... Thank you very much. Very kind of you. The mental development that goes to Buddhism guarantees the purity of the mind, the quality to do good, the beneficial effects of it. Whereas I've actually investigated, you know, into all kinds of meditation processes from different schools, and I noticed that a lot of these schools that give meditation, they do not guarantee the quality, the purity of the mind. It's not guaranteed. Whereas the mental development that goes to Buddhism is special. It guarantees the purity. Any questions? You don't mind, eh? Have a drink? Huh? Okay. That means I can go back. I encounter when I started meditation. Is that the question you asked? Okay. But the problems I encounter may not be the problems you encounter, okay? And the fact that I encounter problems doesn't mean to say when you meditate, you are going to encounter problems. You may not, huh? You understand, huh? Not everybody encounters problems, huh? And not everybody encounters the same problems. But actually, the problems I encounter are the problems relating to the person. Right? I face, because I, for example, I thought I was a very determined person, you know. I thought I was a person when I set my mind to do something that I will stick to it until the end, you know. I thought that was what I was capable of. But when I went into Vipassana meditation, I sat and I said I want to sit for 1.5 hours or something. After 1 hour, I cannot stand any, I got up. You know what I mean? So I said, Mom, you know, Victor, I thought you were supposed to be determined, you know. How come 1.5 hours, 1 hour, you went up, you know, that kind of thing. And the next time I said, I will stay there for 3 weeks. After 2 weeks, I gave up, came home early. You know, these are the kind of problems. Actually, it is just the person is going through a process of facing himself, you know. Alright? And therefore, you see your weaknesses more. Alright? And sometimes you don't want to accept these weaknesses, you see? And face it. You try to run away from it. So the problem is because you try to run away from those weaknesses. I found that I did not have the determination to continue meditating, you see? So I ran off. These are the kind of problems. You expected some funny problems, eh? No. Yes. No. Yes. Same. You know, you're already following it, so it's the same thing. You know? Except that when you go for intensive meditation, meditation teacher tries to purify your virtue further, and he asks you, can you please take the 8 precepts, you know, when you're going for intensive meditation, so you take the 8 precepts so that your virtues become purer. And when you take the 8 precepts, it's easier for the mind to settle down faster, and it goes into those levels easily. Not to say that 5 precepts you won't get in. You can also. But 8 precepts makes it easier. Okay? So, you know, people like monks and so forth, who observe 10 precepts or 220 over precepts, so you know the virtues is so pure, so much so that when you meditate, very fast. They attain very fast. Any more questions? No more? That means I can start passing the hat around and collect donations for myself? No, when you go to church, as the pastor is about to finish the talk, you will pass the collection box around. I think maybe next time we should do it here, pass the collection box around. Then I will take the money, and then throw it up, you know. Whichever that goes up, goes to the temple. Whichever that comes down, belongs to me. If they both going to receive it, all is mine, then, Make sense, No? No more questions? None? Okay. To me? Thank you very much. Bye-bye.